texture. It is a nation not unlike our own in many ways, preparing itself to say thanks for God's generosity. Recognizing each citizen's need to acknowledge God's bounteous blessings of salvation and grace. In doing so, the scripture retells the history of how God rescued their ancestors from the tyranny of oppression, delivering them into a new land of milk and honey. It instructs the Hebrew people on how they can be living reflections of trust and gratitude. This scripture is also the instructions, the rubrics for a worship service, a liturgy to be used by the people in Thanksgiving, which is what makes it so appropriate for us this day because of the common history that now binds us together and for which I will always be eternally grateful. James Forbes once said that most people have in the darkest places of their souls only one all-consuming question that we apply to almost every possible life experience. You want to guess what it is? What's in it for me? How is this going to affect me? I would like to add to Forbes' thoughts by suggesting the churches are no different from people in this regard. Any congregation navigating the changes of time will deep down inside be wondering, is God strong enough? Is God powerful enough to put all of our trust in? Is God trustworthy enough to sustain our well-being if we dare to give ourselves as a church completely and totally to what God is calling us to do or be, even if we are afraid? Do we dare celebrate the bounty of blessings that have been given to us thus far in over 125 years? Will God continue to be so amazingly generous as we move into the future? Our whole lives, the very essence of our existence, lies nestled in the lap of God. Not in the stock market, not in our jobs, not in our families, not in anything in which we have any control. Ultimately, God is in charge. Trying to keep everything under our control is not going to get us anywhere. The Bible is full, from cover to cover, of people like you and me who stopped just short of heaven. They tried and they tried to give it all into God's hands, but they just couldn't bring themselves to let go of some hint of control. And they stopped short. But the standouts, the one that we can count on two hands, Abraham, Jacob, Hannah, Mary, Peter, Paul, their trust was so great that they dared not let their fears, their humanity, stand between them and God's plans for their lives. It's not easy to have that kind of faith. It takes practice. Practice on the little things in our lives, right? So that we're prepared for the big events. Pablo Casals, the great cellist, at 90 years of age, was still practicing 6 hours a day on his cello. And one day, a friend finally called the question, "Pablo, really? You are undeniably the world's greatest master of the cello. Why in the world do you still practice 6 hours a day?" "Because, my dear friend, I think I'm getting the hang of it." God has done great and marvelous work among us and through us in this time we have had together. We can truthfully, honestly come together today with the Levites and the resident aliens among us and celebrate all the bounty the Lord our God has given to us. And the best part of all is that God is not finished yet. There is no Aretha Franklin's father was a minister. And she can still repeat what he used to say each and every Sunday evening before service. He would say, "Children, we are gonna have a big time tonight. We are going to aim at the moon. And if we fall among the stars instead, we will still be on high ground. Aim at the moon, brothers and sisters. The future will be all that you allow it to be. Set your sights so high that only God could possibly make it happen. Aim high." One more little thing I want to mention while I still have your attention. And it is Louis L'Amour's description of the differences in the kinds of stagecoach tickets travelers could purchase. If you have a first class ticket, then no matter what, you never had to leave the comfort, if you could call it that, of your seat. Even if the stagecoach went into the mud or the horses struggled to make it up a hill, you could keep your seat. You didn't have to lift a finger to help. There always seems to be people like that who tend to act as though they have been granted a first-class ticket. And no matter what happens, no matter the needs, what needs to be done, they can sit idly by and watch everyone else struggle to get the coach back on track. You know people like that. And then there are the second-class riders on the stage. They are the bandwagon people. First off, in times of trouble, they hurry off the stagecoach right away. They prefer to watch and wait at a safe distance. Then when the work is done, they climb back on board as though they had earned a part in the victory celebration. But there are those who travel on third-class tickets. When trouble brews and difficulties arise, they are the passengers who get out, roll up their sleeves, and push the stagecoach out of the mud, or replace the wheel, or fight off the bandits. They help the horses by pushing on the back of the wagon to ease the struggle up the hill. I want to tell you this day, I thank God constantly for all the people in this congregation who traveled with me on our journey together on third-class tickets. You have been my life, my joy, and we have grown so close because you rolled up your sleeves and you were not afraid to get a little dirt on your hands. Whatever happens, and whatever you do, don't stop. Continue to be my inspiration in this mission we call ministry. And for all of you, I offer the words of a rabbi from long, long ago. If you deliberately choose to be less than you are capable of being, I warn you, you will be desperately unhappy. If you deliberately choose to be less than you are capable of being, I warn you, you will be desperately unhappy. Have that vision of a bright and glorious future in your sight. Then make a prayerful and conscious decision to choose to buy a third-class ticket. Aim at the moon. The stars in all their glory will pale in the radiance of South Broadway. And you will be able to say with the Hebrew people in sure and certain confidence, "I have obeyed the Lord my God, doing just as you commanded me. Now look down from your holy habitation and bless your people, as you swore to our ancestors. Take these gifts from our hearts, Lord, from the bounteous blessing you have given us."